Today, I want to talk and thank God for the blood of Jesus. I'm going to emphasize on 3 points. I hope I can get through with it. I want to, amen, the purchase of the blood is my first point, amen, and I have an A, B, and C, the purchase of the blood. A precious purchase. The blood is a precious purchase. Number two, it's a personal purchase. And number three, it's a permanent purchase. The blood of Jesus Christ. The Word of God, let's look to the Word of God in the book of Hebrews chapter 9 and from verse 1 to 15. Hebrews chapter 9 and from verse 1 to 15. Okay, let's get there. Hebrews 1, 9 to 15. Let's stand and let's read it together. Amen. Let's stand and let's read it together. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 1. Then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary. For there was a tabernacle made the first, wherein was the candlestick and the table and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. And after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all, which had the golden censer and the ark of the covenant overlaid around about with gold, wherein was the golden pot that had manna and Aaron's rod that budded, and the tables of the covenant. And over it the cherubims of glory shadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly. Now when these things were thus ordained, the priest went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. But in the second, when the high priest alone, once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meat and drinks and divers washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation. But Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption. Praise the Lord. Amen. Please have your seats. Some scholars will tell you that the Bible is the most bloodiest book that has ever been written. From the book of Genesis right down to the book of Revelation, the entire Bible is washed with blood. In fact, when you open the pages of Genesis chapter 3 and verse 14, we read God pronouncing his judgment upon the devil and telling him that he will be beneath cattle, he will be beneath birds, he would go on his belly, and dust shall he live on. And then the following verse tells us where blood would be shed. This is the beginning of the bloodbath that all human beings will have to experience. Because in the conflict between the Satan and the seed of the woman, which is Jesus Christ, we see immediately in tender words, we read that the seed of the woman shall bruise the head of the serpent, and he shall bruise his heel. Blood will begin to flow. In earlier translations, it was much more graphic in its reading, so that the information given here in the King James Version is very polite and mild. Bruise. In earlier translations, you would read, the son of the woman shall crush the head of the serpent, blood. And he will bruise his heel, violently bruise his heel. We see this being depicted in Isaiah chapter 53. When we look at how Isaiah presents Jesus Christ, God's sacrificial lamb, and we take it up from verse 3, we see how Isaiah begins to prophesy about the suffering of Jesus Christ. Despised, rejected. We go on to verse 54, and we see here Isaiah talking about him being smitten and afflicted, blood. But it was not wasteful blood. It was blood that was necessarily shed because God needed a perfect sacrifice. In verse 9 of the chapter we just read, Hebrews chapter 11, and verse 9, we read in Hebrews 9:11, we read that Jesus became the proper high priest. He became the ultimate high priest. Why? Because the blood of goats and bulls, could not have done it. The blood of goats and bulls. Watch it, verse 9 of Hebrews 9:9. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctified to the purifying of the flesh. The next verse. How much more shall the blood of Christ? You see, the blood of goats and bulls. Let's go back to Hebrews 9:9. If the blood of goats and bulls could have done it, then there would be no need for Jesus Christ. Amen. If the blood of goats and bulls could not have done it, there would be no need for Jesus Christ. But as the Bible says, it was just a figure for the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect. It could not have made him perfect as pertaining to the conscience. It could not have wiped away the sins, not even of the high priest. Can you imagine on an annual basis, because all things according to scripture is cleansed by blood, how many millions of barrels of blood would have shed? Just think about it. Because Israel, when they stood before the first tabernacle, when they were given the ordinances of God from Moses' hands, and as they stood to, amen, to offer up, amen, the offerings to God, which was pertaining to the cleansing of the sins of men, you imagine a 1.3 million people had to be cleansed. Think about it, 1.3 million people, that's the population of Trinidad and Tobago. All of us had to be washed with blood. Can you imagine the barrels and barrels and barrels and barrels and barrels of blood had to be shed? How many sacrifices and sacrifices and sacrifices of animals had to be made, and animals had to be killed in order, amen, so that they could be covered? Now, when you think about it, for over 6,000 years, amen, from Moses to Christ, over 6,000 years, can you imagine this thing repeated over and over and over? But yet, there was no cleansing. But when we go, amen, to Hebrews 9:11, we realize that when Jesus, amen, went in there, amen, the sacrifice that he performed, amen, it was once and for all. Verse 12, the sacrifice that he performed, amen, it was, amen, finished by God. The sacrifice, amen, was terminated by God, because a perfect sacrifice had come. A permanent sacrifice had come. It is so important that you recognize that you have been purchased by precious blood. You have been purchased, I repeat, by precious blood. The word of God tells us in Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Let's take a look at it. Romans 5:12. The word of God says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. Death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. Watch at verse 13. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Verse 14. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned, after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him was to come. Verse 15. But not as the offense, so is the free gift. For if through the offense of one man, or of one, many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, had abound to many. In other words, what we have just read there is that because of the sins of one man, amen, death reigned, as the word of God tells us in the book of Romans chapter 6, amen, that the word of God tells us, for the wages of sin is death, But the gift of God is eternal life. In the name of Jesus Christ, I want you to know that we all were bound for death. We were bound for death. Let's take a look at Romans chapter 6. Amen. And see that verse 23. Verse 23. The wages of sin, amen, is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. Sin was making an eternal havoc of man. Amen. And blood had to be there to redeem man. Blood had to be there to sanctify man. Blood had to be there to bring man to God. I want you, amen, to know, amen, that God was looking on, knowing that the seed of the woman is to come. The seed of the woman is to come to deal with the sin problem. Because you see, the sin problem was not just that man was going to be separated from God, but the sin problem brought with it sickness. The sin problem brought with it trouble. The sin problem brought with it weakness. The sin problem brought with it vulnerability, wherein you and I, amen, begin to hate one another, fight one another, curse one another, become violent with one another, amen, upset with one another, because the sin problem in man encouraged the wickedness of man to operate inside a man, so that man lived in sin and became evil and vile. But the blood of Jesus Christ was different from that of the goats and the bulls, because the blood of the goats and the bulls did not bring transformation. The blood of the goats and the bulls, it brought relief so that man could have walked away from the sanctuary or the tabernacle, and he could have walked away, amen, just like, amen, many are doing today with this ashes thing, amen. They committed all the sin, amen, and be a vile, amen, and nasty, and now you can go for ashes, amen, and for a day or two, or even through the entire Lentil period, for the next 40 days or so, you go through a ceremonial kind of cleansing. But however, amen, after that period is over, you go back to the flesh, you go back to the meat, you go back to the kind of wildlife you're accustomed to. Amen. That's what, amen, the blood of the goat and the bulls and the ashes and the sacrificing of the heifer did to those people, amen, back before Christ has come. But I want you to know, you don't, amen, have to live, amen, covered up with ashes and still struggling in your sins. You don't have to live struggling with your weaknesses. Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ just does not only cleanse. The blood of Jesus Christ transforms the sinner. The blood of Jesus Christ changes the sinner. We're going somewhere here tonight. Listen to me. The blood of Jesus Christ was something that was, amen, prepared before the foundation of the world. Prepared. That's what John said. When John saw Jesus, John said, "Behold, the Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." As yet, Jesus had not begun his public ministry. But my goodness, John, being a prophet, amen, realized that the business amen, of the tabernacle, amen, was soon to be over. And so that when John saw him, John said, here comes one who is mightier than I am, whose shoes I'm not able, not even to untie the lace of. Amen. This is the one that I spoke about. I want you to know. Amen. The one that he has spoken about. Amen. He came, amen, to destroy the works of the devil. Because the manifestation that he came to manifest was to, amen, to get rid, amen, of the cancer of sin, was to get rid of the damnation of sin, to get rid of the condemnation of sin. Jesus Christ, amen, that sacrificial lamb, he was on a mission in earth. Isaiah saw him. And in Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 4 to 6, let's read it. Isaiah 53 verse 4 to 6. Amen. Surely he had borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. Amen. But he was wounded for our transgressions. Blood. He was bruised for our iniquities. Blood. The chastisement of our peace. Blood was upon him. And guess what? Amen. Somebody say what? Amen. Somebody ask the question what? Somebody ask the question what? By his stripes. By his stripes. Blood. By his blood. We are healed. Come on and praise God in this church. Amen. We are purchased with personal blood. Hallelujah. It is amazing. Hallelujah. Come on and lift your hands and give glory to God. It is amazing. The blood of Jesus Christ is precious. It is amazing. Romans chapter 5 and 8 verse 8 says, Romans 5:8, amen, God commended his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Hear me, church, amen, the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. God love is in the blood of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you that the blood of Jesus Christ has given to us what we call a personal purchase. Oh God. I like that. A personal. Touch somebody next to you and say, I have a personal purchase. Amen. A personal purchase. Amen. A personal. There's something about having a personal purchase. You know, it is not a rental you're driving. Amen. You like the rental, but it is not a rental. This one is yours. Come on, it's a personal purchase. Amen. Tell somebody next to you, I don't have a rental salvation. No, you don't have a rental salvation. You have a personal salvation. Come on and stand on your feet and give praise to God in this church here this Wednesday evening. Amen. You have a personal, amen, salvation. It's a personal salvation. Give God praise and be seated. You see, the word of God tells us that Jesus purchased us with his own blood.
He did not do like the high priest and went and got animals' blood, the heifer, the cattle, the sheep, and brought it to the sanctuary. He went with his own blood. Listen to me. The depth of this statement, the depth of it, has not nor ever will be plumbed by human minds. Never. How can you think, how can you fathom this? That the righteous demands of a just God had to be met. Think about it. The righteous demands of a just God. Have you ever worked with somebody who is difficult to satisfy? And nothing you do is right? Because it seems as though they are looking for sheer perfection. And when you think you have reached the zenith of your ability, you still fail. Well, the righteous demands of a just God had to be met. To understand this thought demands that we understand how God himself could be born in human flesh. How can you fathom that? That God himself is to be born in human flesh. Think about it. And how could he submit to death? How could God submit to death? This blows the minds of the intellectual and those who are philosophically inclined. It blows their mind that a God who is co-eternal, co-existent, co-creating, could submit himself to human flesh, the rags. In fact, one of my two professors at school, amen, Dr. Ratz, who we read from in his Christology teachings, he said, how can God come in the rags of flesh? He said, but yet, he said to us one day, turn to Philippians chapter 2. This is my lecturer now, Dr. Alistair Alexander, in trying to break down Christology for us. He said, turn to Philippians 2, 5, 11. I beg you to do the same. He said, because this is where we can see how the apostle tries to simplify what the apostle, amen, gave to us concerning Christ. It is known as the kenosis. It is known as the kenosis, pardon me. It speaks about the seven steps of Jesus Christ, or God humbling himself to come in the flesh of man. And he was saying to let this mind be in us. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. We're going down, son, so just keep rolling. Who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God. In the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. Verse 8, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Think about it. Amen. Think about it. Now here it is. It amazes us. The personal purchase that you and I have. That Jesus Christ condescends. He condescends to this low position. He condescends to this low estate. Just so that he can offer precious, sinless blood, according to 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 18 and 19. 1 Peter chapter 1. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, such as silver and gold, from your vain conversations received by traditions from your fathers, verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without sin or without spot. That's the kind of blood that you and I have interaction with. That's the kind of blood, amen, that you have your personal salvation. Listen to me. You have what you need to really know is to have a no-so salvation. You must have that no-so, that nobody, amen, could try to change you or frustrate you. Amen. This is not church. This is not because the music nice and the jamming strong and the preacher, amen, has antics and gimmicks. This is because I know in Manoah, amen, that the blood is for me. Oh, thank God for the cleansing blood. Thank God. Amen. I am washed with the blood. Amen. I have about 6 more points, but I will do one more tonight and close. I want you to know that the purchase that you have received, the purchase that you have received is a permanent purchase. The purchase is a permanent. The verse tells us, the 12th verse tells us, having obtained, take a look, Hebrews, amen, 9:12. Take a look at it. Amen. Having obtained eternal redemption. Having what? Obtained. Eternal redemption. The word having obtained referred to a one time for all time action. I'm going to say that because some of you would miss that. The word obtained referred to a one time for all time action. In other words, the action that was done, amen, close it off one time. The action that was done, close it off entirely one time. It's like you need four runs to beat England as a West Indian team. Amen. And you have Curtly Ambrose in the wicket and Brian Lara in the wicket, and you have four more runs to make with 2 more balls. And you're only hoping that, amen, that Lara stay on the main stump. And you're sitting down in the oval on the edge of your seat. Amen. Or you cock your ears by your radio. And you're watching your TV at home. And you can't sit down no more. You have to stand up to watch them last 2 balls. And you only need 4 runs. But instead of getting 4, Lara hit a 6. Listen to me. That is mash up in the oval. That is mash up in your house. That's what Jesus did when he did it. Amen. He did it better than Lara did it. Amen. He brought home the home run. Amen. He went over the boundary when he made that sacrifice. He went over the boundary for 6. Give me 5 more minutes. Give me 5 more minutes. Let's watch at the verse. Amen. Having obtained eternal redemption, I want to look at the word. Amen. amen, eternal. The word eternal means, by definition, abiding, constant, unending, eternal. To release after the payment of a ransom price. Having obtained eternal redemption. In other words, this price that Jesus had paid to ransom us was a ransom price after, somebody say after, after which the guilty party is forever delivered from all guilt and punishment. In other words, the price that Jesus paid was a once and for all price, so that the devil cannot bring back up nothing in your past. He would not be able even to do what he wants to do with your sin in the present, as long as you stay under the blood. Somebody say under the blood. Under the blood. Come on, church, and stand on your feet. You are under the blood. Hallelujah. When all these truths are coupled together, we are left with the conclusion that the salvation of Jesus Christ provides, and the redemption of the saints enjoys, amen, the blessing of what Jesus has done. Lift your hands everywhere in this church here tonight and thank God for the cleansing blood. The cleansing blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The cleansing blood of Jesus Christ. Come on, church. Cleansing blood. Cleansing blood. Hallelujah. I'm under the blood, where sin can affect me no more. A fountain filled with blood.